heard for those that. So just to let you know, you are being recorded. The reason you're being recorded is because if you are not able to make a class, I do record it and send it out so you can spend some time with us, even though you're not going to be participating. We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I was expecting 3 more, but we have what we have. So we always start on time. We've got some new students with us this evening, and we've got some returning students. So I'm going to start with Carolyn. If you would introduce yourself to everybody and how long you've been part of our class and why you keep on coming back.
That's a good question, Andy. I guess I'm coming back because of you, really. Otherwise, I would not be back. I'm Carolyn Gauder, and I think I've been with Andy since he started these lectures. Was it 6, 7 years ago, Andy?
7 years ago.
7 years ago. And I've just enjoyed them. I find them fascinating, and we've always had a lovely group of people. And I'm actually upset that we're not going to have a full year this year.
No, yeah, I appreciate that, Carolyn. But we'll try and make it. We'll try and make up for it. Thank you, okay. Ruth. Welcome back. If you would introduce yourself and why you came back for your second year.
Hi, my name is Ruth Jatkoff. I'm here at Temple Torah Met in Boynton. I cannot tell a lie. I missed the first 5 or 6 years. I was a Tuesday night Mahjong player, and I was sorry that I missed the classes. But then when the pandemic hit and everything stopped, I was really excited that I'd have an opportunity to be in Andy's class. And I just loved last year, and I'm really glad to be back this year. There are no great games, game or no game, I'm here on Tuesday nights.
Great to have you, Ruth. Mo, welcome back, and you. Introduce yourself and why you came back.
Well, I'm Mo Yaffe. I live in Boynton Beach. This is my second year with Andy, and I keep on coming back because I keep on getting these emails. How great this class is. And I did learn a lot, and I enjoyed the classes last year, so I'm looking forward to this year.
Great to have you. And we have a brand new student. Letty is with us. And Erwin's going to be coming in just a moment, a returning student. And Letty, welcome. If you would introduce yourself to everybody and what brought you here.
Well, I have been a student of yours for a little bit of before this, because I would listen to you with the children, Hip and Baron. And I loved it. You were amazing. And I know you're continue to be amazing. But more a little bit about me. I decided to join the group because of the fact that I've had heard you with Baron, but also the fact that I am in the midst of converting from Catholicism. I've found out about my heritage, but I've gone to many different temples and synagogues and in my past. But I am Ashkenazi and Sephardic Jew. I am Ashkenazi by blood, DNA, and my mother's side is Sephardic. And that's why I'm converting. And I feel that this is where I need to be. So there it is.
Great to have you. Thank you. Thank you. And we have Mr. Wayne Brown. And I must say that Baron has always kept me on my toes. And I know he will this year in HIP. And Wayne Brown, two of his daughters are students of mine. And as Baron is, they are equally keeping me on my feet. So I know we'll have an intriguing class with Wayne joining us. So Wayne, if you would introduce yourself and what brings you here this class.
Well, as you can see, my name is Wayne Brown, and you gave me a great introduction. I ditto everything that everyone else has said. But mainly, I don't think it's fair that just the kids get all the fun with you, Andy. So, this is my shot.
Okay, thank you. And Erwin, welcome back. We're introducing everybody. As you can tell, we've got two new students, Letty and Wayne. So once again, if you would introduce yourself, how many years you've been with us, and why do you keep on coming back?
Because it's enjoyable, and I sometimes learn something as well.
Thank you. And you've been with us, what, 6, 7 years also, right?
At least, yes, correct.
At least, wonderful. And Orly Jacobs, who of course is our esteemed educational director at Temple Torah Emet. I'm honored to have her here tonight. In the 7 years that we've been doing this, This is the first time she has been here. So hopefully she will return. And after she gets done talking to her granddaughter, maybe she'll even participate and keep me on my toes also. So does everybody know Orly? I don't know if everybody knows her. Okay. Mo, do you know Orly?
Only by her reputation.
By name.
I'm looking forward to meeting her, though.
Orly, one of the rules is you gotta unmute yourself because it is fully participatory class.
And well, now I can unmute myself.
All right. And now we also have two other members who do have excused absences, and that's Steve Krawitz and Arthur. They did notify me in advance. So welcome back. Now that we've got all that out of the way, we'll begin. And I think, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, well, almost 7. So I want to talk about the number 7. What, when I say the number 7, what does it do for you? Tell me, what does the number 7 do for you?
7 days of the week, Shabbat.
Okay, good. Top two answers. Good, good, good. Let's see how further deep we can go. What else is the number 7, Bed Ruth?
Just always heard the expression lucky 7.
Right.
Yes.
I don't know where it comes from or what it's about, but lucky 7 seems to be something I, in the back of my head for many years.
Right. Has that worked for you?
No. Not particularly. I never thought about it in relation to myself. Just, you know, out there, I
saw the expression.
Okay. Mo, number 7 in Judaism, what do you think?
I was going to say lucky 7 myself.
Okay. All right.
7. It's got to be, well, it's 49 days before the Omer. So.
All right. That's good. 7 times 7. All right. That's good. 49. Yeah. Good. Good, good, good. All right. Good start. Wayne, what do you think?
I've got nothing except for the fact that maybe it has something to do with there's 7 days in the week.
Well, I said that.
Yeah, correct.
Great minds must think alike.
Yeah. Carolyn, what do you think? Number 7.
I couldn't come up with anything other than 7 days in the week.
Yeah.
Okay, Erwin, what do you think?
An awful lot of things.
I just repeat, I told you.
Oh, you did. I'm sorry. I apologize. All right. So how about this? And it's a good thing that we're here today. And then we're going to relate this, believe it or not, to the new year once we talk about some of these others. So,
right.
First of all, when Noah got off the ark, what kind of laws was Noah given when he got off the ark?
Noah gods.
That's
Noah
right.
Laws.
The Noahbite laws. And by no coincidence, how many Noahbite laws were there, as he asks rhetorically?
7.
Yeah.
7.
Okay, wait. Good start. So there were 7 Noahbite laws. Now, this one, I want you to think for a moment. Assume for a moment that you're in a synagogue, and in the synagogue, there is a menorah.
7 branches.
Yeah.
7 branches of the menorah. And most synagogues absolutely have the 7 days of the menorah. Regrettably, when somebody passes away, yeah. How long do you sit?
7 days.
7 days. Now, how many of us got? How many of us got married?
Got married.
Oh God!
Yeah. Oh, the 7 blessings.
The 7 blessings, right? And in addition to the 7 blessings, in some traditional synagogues. And of course, this practice sometimes is no longer in effect. Ms. Orly, could you verbalize, please?
7 brachot.
Walking, the wife walks around her husband 7 times.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know if there are some weddings where they still do that. There are some weddings where they don't. But there are even some weddings now when they both do it. And even if it's the same gender wedding. So you never know. But yes, 7 times people are supposed to walk around. All right. Now, this one might be just for the ladies, although men indirectly are also involved. And that is, how many days of what's known as the Nida are there?
7.
Boy, we're really beginning to understand what this number 7 does for us. And how many days, original days of Sukkot?
7.
And Pesach? Seven. Ah, now here comes a little bit of a harder one. For those of us that go to shul on Shabbat, how many blessings are there in the Shabbat Amidah?
Seven.
How many aliyot do they have on Shabbat?
Seven.
And now, okay, probably one of the more important sevens that we might think does not apply to anything, which is what I want to focus on a little bit this evening. And that is the following, and it has to do with agriculture. What could the number seven years? Go ahead, Carolyn. 7 years. Go ahead.
7 years you alternate crops.
Yes, 7 years you alternate the crops, and it's also known as
Shemitah.
Yeah. So the next time you're at a Saturday night Jewish trivial contest and somebody says, what does the number seven mean? You now have all the answers. And if you can't remember them, and if you want a copy of this tape, I'll be more than happy to send it to you. So the Shemitah. So this is kind of an odd thing. And why do I focus on the Shemitah today? Very, very, very simple. Because coming up on this Rosh Hashanah, we begin the seventh, the Shemitah year. But there is one thing before I continue that we might not have remembered about the number seven. Okay. So how many months after Pesach is Rosh Hashanah?
In July, August, September, October.
Seven.
Yeah, remember what in the Torah says on the first day of what month? The seventh month. So that's also part and parcel. So let's talk a little bit about this, the Shemitah thing. So what we're supposed to do is not go and agriculture the land. The land is supposed to be given a rest. No crops being planted. And where does that come from? It comes from the Torah. So here we are in the year 2021. Is it still scientifically appropriate? Forget about religion or spirituality for a moment. Is it scientifically appropriate to go ahead and not have the land grow food? Or is that outdated, as many people would suggest, so many other Jewish laws are?
No, it's still being followed in Israel.
Wow. Isn't that amazing? How many other Jewish laws are there on the books that are not being followed? And yet this one, in some cases, are. What makes this one have a little bit higher priority than some of the other Jewish laws?
It's because of the food. It has to do with the food and nurturing the land and being able to continue to feed.
Yes. Yes, but there were so many other Jewish laws that are as appropriate that probably might even have better benefits, but those for the most part are disregarded except by the ultra-Orthodox. So why is it that the Shemitah thing continued? In other words, is it scientifically proven that it actually works?
Yes.
I think agronomists would agree that it's best for the land to let it lay fallow for a year.
Yeah.
Agriculturally, I think that's an agricultural thing, even if it had nothing to do with religion, that it's just good agricultural practice to let the land lay fallow for a year. I don't know.
Wayne, you had your hand up, and with the way you're moving, I sense a bit of disagreement coming.
No, it's not disagreement. It's just I think that we're looking at it the wrong way.
Go ahead.
Not why that one is followed, because it's got significant. I think it's followed because it has significance that everybody can relate to, whereas the others may not continue to be followed. They should have significance, but they don't because of something that we're missing with the other ones. And, you know, it's easiest to it's almost been accepted in the dialectic that it's good to let the fields go fallow for a certain period of time or do crop rotation. That's something that everybody seems to accept as a given for all the reasons that everybody else brought forth. But these ones that we're not following, maybe we should be following those.
maybe that we don't have the connection to those that we should have. And that's the thing that we need to talk about.
Wayne, for those of us that don't understand the word dialectic, which is me, what does that mean?
Well, that it's part of something that everybody accepts as it's a given.
Okay.
You know, it's not high science. It's rudimentary. It's if you ask 9 out of 10 people, they're going to know either letting the field go fallow for a certain period of time or crop rotation or something like that. It's maybe it's because of the age of when I was in school, it's something that they taught, I'm assuming, and this is not to be disrespectful to anybody else in the class, but I think that everybody else is of an age that they probably learned about it in elementary school also. I don't know if they still teach it, but I don't think they do. But I think it's something that we've all come across. So it's just something that has to be second nature to everybody.
So when they taught it in school, and I don't remember them teaching it in school, but it might have been one of those days, rare days that I didn't pay attention. But
he must have taught that in yeshiva.
Yeah, in yeshiva they did, but it might have been one of those days I didn't pay attention and the ruler came out or something. But for those of us that can appreciate that humor, when they teach it in regular school, if they do, do they ever relate it to its origin?
No, probably not.
But there are so many other things that are brought to the origin. And without talking about politics, which we never do, by the way, I wanted to make that point very clear. The president today referred to Isaiah in his speech to the country. So right. The prophet Isaiah.
Well, I want to go back a little bit because they to my recollection, the best of my recollection is that we learned about it when somewhere around the time or related to reading about, the Great Depression or the Grapes of Wrath, when they weren't good stewards of the land, when the farmers allowed the fields to get depleted of their nutrients and crops were failing, part because of the Dust Bowl, but part because it was poor farming habits. So yeah, there was definitely some connection to why this became a smart thing to do and why farmers did it. So there was a connection.
And Wayne, to your point about the Dust Bowl, when the Dust Bowl occurred and they went back to look as to why it occurred, guess what they concluded?
They didn't follow the land.
Exactly right. They did not follow, whether they were Jewish or not, it doesn't matter. They did not follow the Jewish guidance of Shemitah, and that actually was contributory to the famous Dust Bowls. And scientists have actually proven that this ancient Jewish technique, it was exactly what the land needed. Now, what changed? Something very dangerous. Because today, when people do not do the Shemitah in America and around the world, they use something called pesticides. And the pesticides are now being used in replacement for crop rotation. And what was crop rotation? Crop rotation was, in fact, an outcome of the original Shemitah. So when we begin to look at the foods that have pesticides in them, and if we knew in advance, which we do, but we kind of disregard it, if we went to the supermarket and there was a big sign that said, this food contains pesticides, how would we feel?
We wouldn't buy it.
Did you ever notice that most other foods have their ingredients on there? Except for agricultural foods, they don't tell us they have the country of origin. They tell you where the fish is from. They tell you where the meat is from, what country and all the rest of that stuff. But nowhere does it say, beware of pesticides. and they had the pesticides in order to get more out of the land. And it becomes very interesting that we do this once every 7 years, but I think some of the lessons are even deeper than that. So imagine for a moment that, as Wayne pointed out, we began to take a look at other Jewish laws. Do you have your hand up, Mo?
No, I'll just.
Okay. So imagine for a moment we have some other Jewish laws that we don't understand their application to today's world. And it's interesting, we talked about the number seven. Watch this. The number seven in Hebrew is, how do we say it, seven in Hebrew, or the Hebrew day? Hashvi'i, right? Yom Hashvi'i, the seventh day. What is the root of the word Hashvi'i?
Sheb? No.
Yeah. And what does Sheb mean?
Sit.
Which also means to rest.
Oh, yeah, correct.
Because okay. If you take the word Yoshev, it right. means to what? To rest. So isn't that interesting that you have the name number, which we started out with, Hashvi'i, which can be related to resting. So if we rest the land on Shabbat and give it a chance to re-energize, what would happen if we all did the same thing as humans every Shabbat?
We'd probably live longer.
Rejuvenate.
Yeah, wouldn't we? We would rejuvenate. And that tends to escape us, doesn't it? Many, many people. We tend to say, you know what? I don't really need it. Oh, I'm okay with the Shemitah thing. I'm okay with Israel doing that. And there are still kibbutzim that do that. And I'm cool with that. But you know what? When it comes to Yoshev and to sit and shave and Yom Hashvi'i and all the other things that we concluded are related to the number seven, all of a sudden, well, you know what? It's good for the land, but it might not necessarily be good for us. What do you think about that?
True.
Yep. We don't have enough time in a day.
It is good for us, though.
It is. Yeah, it is. Yeah. No, it's fantastic for us. And it's been proven, as we've talked about in the past, and that's one of the ways where this whole Shemitah thing, especially with the new year coming. So let's kind of move a little bit forward and say, all right, this coming Rosh Hashanah, the head of the year, is the Shemitah year. Wonderful. What are we going to do, watch this connection, to fertilize ourselves during the coming year?
Take care of ourselves.
Okay.
We're gonna cleanse ourselves to start fresh.
Yes.
Start fresh.
Okay.
Oh, absolutely. Good. And don't we do that every morning when we take a shower?
No. Certainly.
And what happens by the time the next day comes, we're filthy again, right? So I hear what you're saying, Wayne. We're going to cleanse ourselves, but what will we do to make sure that we don't get messy again? Will we take that year and say to ourselves, wow, I'm giving the agriculture, I'm giving the land a year to refertilize, to rest, to grow, to energize, to not be impacted by economic and outside forces like the wind. And maybe, just maybe, this year, I can learn a lesson from that. Carolyn, what do you think?
Interesting concept.
Not followed.
Yeah, Erwin, you agree with that? I'm waiting for somebody to disagree with me.
Well, isn't the whole
to disagree with.
Go ahead, wait.
Give us some time. Isn't the whole mishpacha about the fact that the Torah starts at the beginning of the year or the beginning of the Jewish year and then ends, and that it's supposed to be cyclical, and you've got an opportunity every year to do things the right way and to try to be the best Jew that you can be, or the best example of humanity that you can be. So it goes together. I mean, it makes sense that we have 7 days in the week, especially because of the importance of seven that you've talked about. And certainly that can be transposed into 7 years and letting the field go fallow once every 7 years. So mm-hmm. so it can cleanse in the hopes that next year it will produce a better crop.
You're on to something. Somebody expand on that. Somebody expand on that. Wayne is definitely on to something. Somebody expand.
Well, what I wanted to say, I was not aware that this Rosh Hashanah begins a Shemitah year, but in my experience, it's almost like every year Rosh Hashanah, we always think about it as being a new beginning, a new start, an opportunity to better yourself and repair the world. In other words, why is this one different from the other Rosh Hashanahs? You know what I'm saying? I've always felt that it's almost as if you're starting over every year.
No.
So the Shemitah is just an extra part of it thrown in. But I can't relate to it being exceptionally different from what usually starts from Rosh Hashanah to Yom Kippur and going forward.
Ah, great question. Before I come up with an answer, anyone want to try and answer Ruth's really deep, insightful thing? Go ahead, Wayne.
It's like a reaffirmation. It's not that you shouldn't do it every year. It's just that that seventh year has significance because it's almost like a reaffirmation, the same way that it just happens to be 7 years and then let the field go fallow, so that it can produce better after that year that you allowed it to go fallow. So I think it's along the same lines that, yes, you're absolutely right. And I agree with what you said, that every year you're supposed to have another shot at it, another bite at the apple. But you know, this one should be that much more important. It's almost kind of like a wake up call. They give you 7 years to see if it pans out. And in the seventh year, okay, we're going to let you know how important it is this time. I don't know.
Or maybe you should just
somebody
review.
Build on that. You're on the right path, Wayne. Go ahead, buddy.
Maybe you just review the past 7 years and what you've been able to accomplish or change or not, and then be able to say, okay, now that I've seen what I've done in the last 7 years, here's my next step, and this is what I should now look forward into the next 7 years and going from there.
Okay, good. Erwin, you're Mo, I'm sorry, Erwin, then Mo. It looked like you wanted to say something, Erwin.
No.
Okay, Mo?
I'm just saying that the Shemitah year gives you a chance to revitalize yourself. And every Rosh Hashanah, you make the pledge to do something better and make yourself better, but we never really get there. So this year is the year, every year is the year that we start over again. Try to be better.
Very close. Anyone else? Here we go.
How about making that seventh year even like bigger and better? It's not just replenishing yourself, which is what we are supposed to do every year. That seventh year, not only replenish ourselves, but maybe replenish our surroundings, our home, our gardens. You know, take that Shemitah and bring it to your own home and do the same for yourself. You know, take that, get that itch and do other things of surrounding your community and not just yourselves.
Okay.
So adding to what Miss Orley said, I always call it Miss Orley, adding to what Miss Orley says, I think she's including caring for the environment, because how many of us really during a year time period really focus on what am I doing to either destroy the environment or what am I doing to enhance the environment? Because remember the old adage, either you're part of the problem or part of the solution. But I think it goes one step deeper. Watch this. Here we go on Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, all the way through Hoshana Rabbah, when we take the leaves and we bang them and they fall off and our sins are all gone. And then finally the book is sealed and we go through the whole thing. And 3 weeks later, do we remember what we pledged?
No.
Maybe 3 weeks is even too long. 2 weeks later, do we remember what we pledged? No. It's forgotten. But to answer your question, Ruth, if you see the land for the entire year laying fallow, it teaches us, or should, that, hey, there are short-term things that we tend to forget, but during the Shemitah year, it gives us all year to reflect and remember of the pledges and the promises that we made in the beginning of the year, because we have to live with that fallow land all year. And it acts as a reminder all year that, wow, just like the land is, change is not short term. Change is long term. Change is a process. For those of us that say, man, I can change on a dime, I think you're shortchanging yourself, pun intended. But on the other hand, if you give it long term, you've got a much better chance of getting your goals, and be it secular or religious, accomplished.
But then Shabbat should be the same way, in that it's every 7 days you have this opportunity to think about what you did the week before and how you can improve upon that for the week coming. So not only is it a rest, but it's a time for reflection as well. And it gives you that opportunity, kind of like the, what is it? Think globally, act locally. You know, it's kind of like micromanage. You know, take care of the little thing, the here and now, and it will take care of the rest. So it's big picture, little picture kind of thing.
Andy, I have a question.
Yes.
Those of us don't live on farmland, don't see the fields empty for the year. How are we to remember that this is something that we should be cognizant of for the whole year? Is this something that the rabbis refer to in the course of the year? Does the schools teach this to the kids in the course of the year? Are they aware of it? Because going back to, you know, my childhood in schooling, I knew the concept and I knew the word, but I can't ever remember being made aware of it on a regular basis while I was in Hebrew school or Sunday school or confirmation or even my bat mitzvah class.
So to answer your question, Ruth, most likely not, which is for those of us that have been with us for a while, I always come up with this line. If you learn something new in these classes, find your old Hebrew school principal and ask for your money back.
You can come to my house and look at my garden. My garden is empty and will be for a year.
Oh, okay.
I think that's a wonderful lesson for the children. I really do.
But the problem with, I'm going to put my principal hat on, the problem with teaching and doing in the religious school is by the seventh year, those kids are gone.
Right.
So in principle, you can teach it. You can't, you just can't do it. That's the problem.
Okay.
But my husband does that with our land. We have a vegetable garden, and every 7 years, sometimes it's every five years. It depends on how bad it is. But usually,
give him a new calendar.
We let it go, and we have no veggies for a year.
So
Andy,
I want to go back to Ruth for a second. So hold your thought for just 1 second, so I can answer her for a moment. Okay. So it has to do with the fact that we also don't teach our kids that because of time and lots of other things, that originally the Jews were not bankers, we were not entertainers, we were not comedians and all these things that we're known for today. We were, in fact, the chief agricultural experts in the world until they took the land away from us, okay? Because they felt that we were poisoning their food. They took the land away from us, and that was our... But years back, our ancestors, they were all agricultural giants. So how do we get involved in this, given the time and given the students, and et cetera, et cetera? Yeah, we need to stress more and more that we were agricultural experts in the world, which, by the way, we still are in Israel.
Yes.
Because we do more with the land in Israel than anybody else does. And for those that practice the Shemitah there, that is one of, including many others, contributory reasons. So, yeah. So hopefully that will help answer your question. Should that be more focused from a Bima? Yeah. Should it be more related to everyday life? Absolutely. Mo, I'm sorry I cut you off. I think you wanted to say something.
I just wanted to say that Shemitah, I didn't realize how Kabbalistic it is when you think of it, what a deep thought there is to it. And I'm also wanted to say, when you go to Israel, I want you to try and go to the Shemitah field and find some of the leftover fruit.
Right.
Ah, okay. All right. So here's something else that's interesting in Shemitah. So if you do not go ahead and toy the land on the seventh year, does the land produce double food the sixth year?
I don't think so. No. I don't think so.
All right. So what are you supposed to do 1 year without food?
Well, what they do is they buy it from neighboring, like from Italy or some other country.
You have multiple fields. You have multiple fields and you rotate.
That's right, the rotation, right?
I don't know.
Okay, so
I haven't been over there.
Are you suggesting, Wayne, that every year, even though this is an official Shemitah year, every field has a different one? Is that what you're suggesting?
Yes.
We have some disagreement here. Mo, go ahead.
I don't think so. I think Shemitah is Shemitah, and if you go through Israel, all the fields are fallow. Okay. That's what I've heard from people who visited during Shemitah year.
But then why did you ask Andy when he goes that he should look for a Shemitah field?
Because
he should be all over the place in that year.
No, you can still eat the crops that grow, but you just can't grow anything on it, you know, plant it. So if there's leftover crops, you can still eat from it.
So you think they plan to have leftover for that year?
Yes.
Okay, there's the answer then.
Well, there's also another answer, and by the way, I think earlier wrote that you do rotate the crop, and she just wrote, from what I learned and from what we saw in Israel, farmers split their field and rotate them. Yes, and that's right. One way around it. The other way is another deeper lesson that all of us should take to heart, and that is when you have an abundance of something, do you spend it right away?
Save some, but.
You're supposed to save. And if you take a look at Jewish financial success, isn't a lot of Jewish financial success not being cheap or not Jewing people down? It is, in fact, financial planning, right? It is, in fact, that if you have an abundance of funds for 1 year, do you go out and spend it all or do you save it? You save it for a rainy day.
Yeah, it's in the history. You don't spend it, you save it, and that's what you do with the foods as well, right?
Yep.
There's ways that you can actually conserve the food in many ways and have them for the next harvest. And then as you know, the following year that you've got to stop and have the land be followed.
Yep. And you just reminded me of something about the number seven, and I might be wrong here, but I'm gonna take a risk. In the Torah, how many, at the time of Joseph, how many years of barren food was there and how many years of fulfilling food was there?
7 years of bad and 7 years of plenty.
Yeah, 7 years. So what did we learn from Joseph that we learned from Shemitah? And that is, as you know you're going to have it, save some of it, store it, or do whatever you can do to make it safe without all those chemicals. So here you have again a life lesson from something that prior to that didn't get much thought. And now we've shown two or three different ways how we can apply it to life today. And that's is extremely intriguing. But now we have something else. After the seventh year and the land grows back on the eighth year, what are we supposed to do the eighth year?
Think anew.
Good. What else? And celebrate the new food. Celebrate that the land has come back.
Correct.
And what does that teach us in life? Not to take things for what?
Granted.
For granted. And didn't many of us do that pre-COVID? there were so many things that we did. Yeah. You know, I find it interesting, a little dilemma here, or actually good news. So is anybody here from New York City originally? No. So for those that are from New York City, I am not expressing personal opinion. I'm just speaking general observation that might be somewhat insulting, but I am not attempting to insult you. I am just referring what other people have said as a communicator. So did I establish those parameters correctly?
Clearly.
Okay. So when you think of New Yorkers, sometimes people think, you know, especially New York Jews, that they live in a land of entitlement. I'm entitled to this, I'm entitled to that. And I see some faces going crazy, but here I live in a community 55 plus like many of you do. And we have a lot of New Yorkers, which I'm originally one of them, but I live more out of New York than I did in New York. And people run around entitled. I'm entitled to this, I'm entitled to that. You got to do this, you got to do that. But you know what happened during COVID?
It all went away.
Most of it went away. Those New York personalities with I'm entitled to everything and you best be giving it to me. A lot of that philosophy went away.
It depends. Go ahead.
And a lot of that went away. Not all of it, but a lot of it went away. And it relates back in a way to Shemitah because we think we're entitled to everything. But once every 7 years when the land isn't growing food, what happens? We begin to say, wow, how grateful we are for what we have. And I can't wait for the year to be over so that I can get fresh food and the land can once again produce food. What do you think about that?
Some people got the message and some didn't.
Erwin, what do you think about that type of comparison? That it teaches us not to take things for granted.
In theory, it works. I'm not sure if it works in practice.
Okay, that's fair. No, that's absolutely fair. That's absolutely fair. So what prevents it from working it in practice, in reality?
People.
Oh, okay.
That's right, Erwin. That's right. That's it.
Simple. Very simple.
The same with our COVID. I hate to go political. With the no sayers of vaccine and people who do take vaccine.
Mm-hmm. No, I hear you very clearly. So when we take a look at all these things having to do with the number seven and how it relates to Rosh Hashanah and how it relates to our life, it becomes that much more interesting. So you know what? When we started off and we said seven, everybody said lucky seven. Okay. Now we've had a deeper discussion about the number seven. Carolyn, is number seven lucky or is it fate?
I don't know. I've always thought of nine as lucky, not seven.
Oh. Wow, that's great. Carolyn and I are on board. You go, Carolyn. Me too. Number nine.
Okay. So then I'll rephrase the question momentarily. How do you feel about the number seven now as it relates to Judaism and our personal lives?
Yeah, I certainly learned now why seven is more important in certain aspects and why we should think about it, which I never thought about before, other than the 7 days of the week.
Right,
but,
right.
As usual, you've taught us something new.
Yeah, I'm just doing a up to this point summary, and then we'll move further. We're not that done yet. Letty, how about you? What's your feelings about number seven and how it relates to Judaism? And I'm going to take it a step further because this is relatively newer to you, based on your beginning exposure to Judaism. So, right. What do you think?
No, it's absolutely. From what I have read as well, it makes a lot of sense. It plays a very important role in Judaism. It plays a very important role in many aspects, definitely.
And Ruth, I think you originally said lucky seven, or somebody did?
I don't even know where the lucky came from, but I never stopped to relate it to my Judaism. I mean, mm-hmm. Obviously from our discussion tonight, I've seen how much more meaningful Shevin is to Judaism than I ever thought about it before. I mean, I was aware of 7 days of the week, and I knew about Shemitah and all these other sevens, but I never considered it having anything to do with lucky. So I don't know where that came from.
Okay,
That's from the Goyish world, I guess.
But it's all right. So let me try a different way. Now that you know a lot about seven, would you consider it lucky?
No.
Who said no? Wayne. All right, Wayne, go for it.
I think it's not that it's not lucky. It's just that lucky or not lucky is not the significance of the seven.
Okay.
It's almost like the mitzvot are altruistic. You want to meet them all. And if you meet them all, you're going to benefit from it. Well, if you let your field go fallow every 7 years, you're going to benefit from that because you're going to have better crops. If you go to synagogue on Shabbat, you're going to have better weeks because you took that time to reflect and to rest and to think about something other than the normal grind. So you benefit from that. It's not so much that which came first, the chicken or the egg? Does some mysticism make it lucky, or does just doing the right thing produce a good result? And doing the right thing produces a good result. So some people might think it's lucky because it just happens, but it happens because of what you're doing, your behavior. So I think it's just it's not really lucky. It's you're creating the situation and you're making it better. So it can be seen as luck by some, the casual observer, as it were, but it's not really lucky. Does that make sense at all, the way I tried to explain it?
The jury, you're a lawyer, so I'll answer it this way. The jury's out.
I'm still out on it. I still want to find out where they decided 7 days a week are going to be 7 days a week. What is the significance of 7 days? How did we get there?
I just, if you guys look at the chat, yeah. I actually just Googled it and researched it as we were talking. And it says quite a bit on the Judea side and how it relates to different processes of the 7 days. And so if you read it through, you have all different, rationales behind it.
I'll go ahead and read it through. Biblical scholars point out that the number seven is quite significant in the Bible. In the creation story, God made the world in 6 days and rested on the seventh day. Scholars have found that the number seven often represents perfection or completeness in the Bible. In Judaism, which I had forgotten, there are seven heavens. And to answer your question about where the 7 days came from, it is from the Torah. Yeah. And to also answer the question, what came first, the chicken or the egg? There should be no debate on that whatsoever.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
There should be no debate as to what came first, the chicken or the egg.
Yep.
Why I say that? Why do I say
you're
that?
You're begging the debate.
Yeah. Why do you argue what they said?
I say that because in the Torah, okay, the story of creation that we are celebrating on Rosh Hashanah, which when we go to services, we admit that God created the world because that's what Rosh Hashanah is about, right? The head of the year. And it is the seventh month, the first day of the 7 month of the year. We are clearly, whether we want to do it or not, admitting that God created the world. If God created the world, he didn't create the egg first. God created the chicken first. So therefore, there should be absolutely no debate, especially on Rosh Hashanah. Mo, I think you were trying to say something earlier and you didn't get a chance.
Oh, yes. I was wondering why in your dissertation you haven't told us a word that actually numerically equals to 7.
Help me out.
You know, when you went to Yosheve, I thought you were going to say, oh, that equates. And the,
with gematria?
Okay. Yeah, right. Gematria.
Yeah. You know, yikes. You know, here's why I didn't do that. Because I made a commitment to Carolyn, and she said she's been with us for 7 years and had never repeated a topic. And I did a topic a couple of years ago on gematria. So
okay.
You think I remember that?
She doesn't remember it.
Oh boy. Yeah.
That's a great one. That would be a nice one to repeat.
You know what? Maybe maybe I'll just expand on it and come up with some new stuff after the refresher. But no, that was a good call. It's in the back of my head. I have to know it, but I can't draw it out. But that's a good question. Okay, so we have 7 days of creation. We got that. Yeah. So, Wayne, do you agree with me that since we are celebrating Rosh Hashanah, the day of God created the world, as a birthday, that there should be no debate about the chicken and the egg?
No.
Take Shemitah and think about it.
I'm interested in how you're going to get out of that one.
because you could think of it this way, that the egg and the chicken are one and the same, that it's just a different stage of life. So he could have just as easily created the egg that the chicken grew from, and then that chicken created another egg. It's just the first egg was created by God. That's all.
Okay.
If you can find something in any scholar that relates and identifies with the statement you just made, I will yield.
Well, what comes first? Daylight or darkness?
Vayihi erev, vayihi boker. So the evening came first.
Right, according to the Bible, right?
Right. So how does that help your argument?
But why do we think of the evening as the end of the day instead of the beginning of the day?
We in Judaism, the evening is the beginning
Judaism
of the day.
We don't, but the rest of the secular world does.
Oh, Wayne, I'm so glad you asked me that question, because the rest of the world does consider the evening as a new day. You ready for this, Wayne? You're not going to be happy.
No, midnight.
What happens at midnight?
Right. The new day.
And what time period in a 24-hour period is midnight?
12 o'clock. No, it's 24th hour.
It's also known as the evening, the night. So 12 midnight is in the middle of the night. That's when the new day starts. We happen to do it by the moon. I got that. But it's still the whole thing with the night. So they once again followed us, because they could have easily said the new day starts at 6 o'clock in the morning, which they don't. Correct?
Well, yeah, but we gauge it more about sunrise, sunset than the secular world, don't we?
Sunrise? No, things start at night.
Because Shabbat starts at sunset on Friday, right?
18 minutes before, yes.
Okay. So in Judaism, sunrise and sunset divide the days more so than the median, more so than 12 midnight.
Erwin, you're chomping to participate. Go ahead.
I'm postulating.
I'm sorry, what?
I didn't say a word.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Say something.
Just move it around.
I thought you were trying to say something. I apologize. Anyway.
Somebody say something.
Is it that long?
Next subject.
No, I want to know, when does the day start?
Good question. The day in the Jewish religion, the next day starts in the evening. And it's a moving target, because it's directly related to when the sun goes down and the moon comes up.
Right.
That's the evening. So we agree.
Oh, yeah. I didn't
but what does it have to do with the chicken and the egg?
But it does have to do with it. Because if the life starts with the egg, right, then you'd have to have the egg before you'd have the mature chicken. If the life starts with the chicken, all right, and the chicken produces the egg, then the life starts with the chicken, with the mature chicken.
Yes, again, according to the Torah, which the chicken came first. God created the animals first, and then he taught the animals how to reproduce. The chicken reproduces through an egg. Therefore, the egg came from the chicken, and the chicken came first.
If you put it that way, I can accept that.
Okay.
Thank goodness.
Okay, it only took me 7 minutes, but that's okay.
That's all.
All right. So,
I can accept that as a biblical construct. Okay.
Okay. So let's go back and see where we're at. Okay. So Miss Orley said that, which is interesting. I didn't know this in advance. That you do follow the rules of the Shemitah in your backyard, correct? Which is terrific, right? Oh, she went off screen, and I think we were also able to really relate it to what's coming up this particular year. And I happen to agree with everybody, but with Ruth when she mentioned it should be taught more, it should be understood more, it should be relatable more to everybody, because it creates a much deeper appreciation for what all the laws of Judaism have to do. And I think we put it in there too. I'm just going to read this. Seven trumpets played by seven priests for 7 days. That's right, to bring down the walls of Jericho. Seven things that are detestable to God, and seven pillars of the house of wisdom. Wow.
Yep.
All good stuff. And now, as I'm counting through this, it really, really brings us to date. So what I wanted to do this evening is, again, talk about the Lucky Seven, talk about in addition to what I introduced, what everybody else introduced about seven, talk about Shemitah. And as we get together for Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and of course, Slichot this coming Saturday night, wherever you will participate in a Slichot service, keep it in mind. So let's do what we always do with a wrap up. Erwin, any the closing comments or anything you'd like to add to what we discussed this evening?
No, I follow and accept Shemitah lore, and I have no reason to practice it. I have no soil.
Okay, all right, but again, it not only can be practiced agriculturally, the important thing is it could be practiced mentally, as we take all year to fertilize and cultivate our long-term secular and spiritual plans, quite frankly, for the balance of our life.
But this should be done every year.
It should be, but isn't. Wayne Brown, your reactions.
My reactions to the whole discussion?
Yeah.
Well, I'm still thinking about Darwinism and Trinity creationism.
Oh my God.
All right. Let me help you with that real quick.
It was wonderful.
Let me help you with that real quick. In the last week, I was in the place where Darwin supposedly discovered this theory of Darwin's evolution. And that was, of course, in the Galapagos Islands. Oh, and I had the pleasure of being there last week and learned about how Darwin came up with his magnificent theories, et cetera, et cetera. Saw the lizards and all these other nice little animals that he based his theory on. So we don't have the time to expand this, but I only have one question. And some of you might have heard me ask this. If Darwin's theory of evolution is correct, how have the humans evolved over the past 2,000 years?
don't think Darwinism and creationism are mutually exclusive.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay, all right. We'll pick that up at another discussion. Maybe when Bereshit comes around, we'll do
and
something.
And I think a lot of great scientists agree with me.
Interesting, Carolyn. Your reactions, impressions about this evening.
I certainly learned things that I didn't know before. That's a given, but that's with every class that you teach. And I did find it very interesting. I think I agree with most of it. And I think that considering that Rosh Hashanah is coming up shortly and what's going on in the world, we do have to really think about it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And Letty, this was your first class with us. What do you think?
Yeah, no, I really enjoyed it. And it taught me a lot. And the most important, the impact that for me it made is the fact that I really have to let myself re-energize and in ways take advantage of this year for that. Very important.
Thank you, Mo.
Well, I never thought about Shemitah the way this class evolved when you were talking about sevens. I knew about Shemitah. I witnessed it, but now I have a better understanding and a new way to think about it.
Okay, so next year, starting probably the next class, I forget when the next class is, but if it's after Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur, I would assume that the picture behind you will not have grass on it.
That picture doesn't change much. And I can take no credit for it.
Okay. And Ruth.
You know, when you mentioned your greater appreciation, once you have not had this stuff for a year and you come into the new year and you appreciate what you didn't have and how much more it's meaningful to you, I really can relate that to the past year and a half that we've been through with COVID, because I think that all of us have come to realize we were so cut off from the world and all the people we loved and all the things that we knew, and so much greater appreciation now of what was in our lives and what we hope to have back in our lives when things become more normal. And I think we can relate that, the whole thing of being without something for a period of time and looking forward to having it again. I think it's really important.
And I don't know if Miss Orley wants to comment before we conclude. Doesn't look like it. So we'll meet again next time. We will be joined by three other students. Alan Schoen, I guess, couldn't make it tonight. And I knew about two other students. So we will invite and welcome three other folks that will join us. And again, if I don't get a chance to talk to you, have a good new year. Notice I didn't say happy new year, because when you say Shana Tova, that does not mean happy new year. It means have a good year. And we all have a tendency to misinterpret that. And there is a difference between happy new year and good year. And basically, what's the difference? And it really goes back to Shemitah for a moment. When you say happy new year to someone, after 3 weeks of the new year, you basically don't say happy new year anymore, whether it's in the secular calendar or the English calendar. But when you say have a good year, that is all inclusive of all 365 days. So with that being said, have a good year. We should all be written in the book of life, in the book of health, in the book of sustenance. And I look forward again to being with you guys. And thanks so much for tonight.
I see
thank
this
you.
Here as a second.
Stay safe, everybody.
All right, Erwin, go ahead.
I see there's a class of 10 per second. Isn't that before our
Oh, is it? Okay, great. All right, I'd better get ready. Okay.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Good night, everyone.
Night.
Good night. Take care.
Night.
Bye-bye.